Noam Chomsky has said that the news media are profoundly reactionary. Noam, what do you mean by that?
What I mean by that is that they overwhelmingly tend to be subordinated to centers of power. And I should say that I don't really mean to distinguish the news media from the intellectual culture in general. And furthermore, I think that this is close to tautological in any society. That is, those sectors that are not subordinated to power are going to be marginalized and externalized and so on. You can trace this right back to the earliest recorded history. You could go back to, say, the Bible and ask yourself, who were the people who were respected during the period covered by the Old Testament? Well, the answer is it was the people we call the false prophets. The people we call the prophets were canonized hundreds of years later. They were people who were imprisoned and beaten and driven into the desert and reviled and so on. The people who were respected were those who catered to the powerful, later, centuries later, called the false prophets. And any society with an unequal concentration of power, which means any society of the kind that exists, is going to have that property. There will be what are sometimes called the bought priesthood, or the commissars, or whatever name you want to use for them, who will serve the interests of the powerful, and naturally they will be rewarded for that service. And they'll tend to be in positions of influence, prominence, authority, and so on. And those who whose point of view and material they produce and attitudes are considered subversive to power, undermining it, will naturally tend to be marginalized. Societies differ in the way this happens. Like, for some, it's death squads. For others, it's a gulag. For others, it's not getting a job. I mean, you know, big differences, and those are very important differences. There's a big difference between being, say, in Central America, where you're likely to get cut to shreds and left by a roadside ditch, and being like us, where maybe, you know, somebody doesn't like you, or you know, get called bad names or something, or lose a job if you're young, that kind of thing. But so there are differences, but the mechanisms will of course vary from society to society, but the outcome is not so different. In fact, I've done a lot of detailed analytic work on the most interesting case, the media in free societies, where there is very little in the way of state coercion comparatively, and it's striking how similar the media output is to what you find in totalitarian states. Actually, that's a point that was made by Orwell, in a very interesting way. Orwell's Animal Farm, everyone knows about. Mm-hmm. Very, you know, it's a satire on the enemy, mm-hmm. The totalitarian enemy. However, Orwell wrote an introduction to Animal Farm called "On Literary Censorship in England," and that wasn't published. It wasn't published for about 30 years. Somebody finally dug it up and published it in the 70s, about 30 years after the book appeared. And in it, he pointed out that England is obviously very different from Russia, you know, but he said the literary censorship is not all that different. And he even gave the reasons. He said the reason is that, first of all, he said the press is owned by wealthy men who have every interest in not having certain ideas expressed. And then he said there's a system of indoctrination in which you simply learn the values of the society, and you just learn, you know, you go through Eton and Oxford and so on, and then you have just internalized the values, and you know there are certain things you just don't say. And he said the combination of these two factors, the socialization, which we call education, which is basically indoctrination, and then just the whip, you know, the people, the fact that wealth is concentrated. He said the outcome of these two effects is that you do have literary censorship in England, the free society, which is not so different from what you get in a totalitarian society. And as if to prove his point, it didn't appear. You know?
Now, as to that difference, because there would be a difference, the media, you've written, must maintain the illusion that there is in fact freedom, that there is not de facto censorship. So how does this happen? How does it come that the journalists, as I believe, actually are self-deluded into believing that they're not into self-censorship? And how do you see that mechanism operating?
Well, for one thing, it's by no means uniform. I mean, there is openness in the media. In fact, they're a lot more free and open than they were 30 years ago, mm-hmm. just as a result of the popular activism of the years, which has just changed the culture. So it's a more open culture, and you get more open media. And there are plenty of journalists, including some who are very distinguished and well-known, who wouldn't describe the media in terms any different from what I did, except that they wouldn't do it publicly because they wouldn't have a job very long, but they'll do it privately. There are plenty of people working in the media who, in fact, some of the most prominent investigative reporters and others, who essentially try to play the system. They see how far they can go, they look for openings and so on, and there are just plenty of people with real professional integrity who just do very honest and accurate reporting and sometimes get it through and sometimes they get stepped on and so on. But for the most part, I think what you say is correct, for the most part it's self-delusion. So say to take someone like, for example, Tom Wicker, who was the leading liberal commentator in the New York Times for many years. He was really upset when people said that he was supporting power. He said, look, I write anything I like. Nobody ever tells me what to write.
Sure.
And that's true, because if he hadn't internalized the values of power, he would not be allowed to write. But once he has internalized them and he's shown that he's going to say the right things, it's absolutely true that no one will ever tell him what to write. He'll never get out of line. It's inside, like Orwell said.
Now, what about some of the examples, the more horrendous, shall we say, examples of the reactionary role of the media resulting in vast omissions and censorships? I'm thinking, for instance, if I'm not mistaken, please correct me, of the Holocaust itself, that when the media coverage, which as it was then, radio and print, of the Holocaust is examined, that it was a non-story and so forth. Is that true? And what other examples are there of vast events?
That's true, and that's a horrible example, but I don't think it's a very telling example.
Mm-hmm.
For one thing, I should say it was all, there have been reviews, studies in Hebrew, of the Hebrew press at that time, and it's not so different in what is now Israel. It was in Palestine. It was kind of downplayed, and it wasn't put off for a long time. In fact, when you read the reports from 1942 and so on in the Hebrew press, it's pretty appalling. And there are many reasons for it. The Holocaust, first of all, it was a maybe the most horrifying single event in history, but it nevertheless was covered by the fact that it was during a war. There was a war going on, and everyone was focused on that. Now, you can say, and in fact correctly, that refusal to give this appropriate attention was grotesque. Nevertheless, it can be, I don't think it's a case of private power, let's say, having an influence. The fact is also that the governments didn't pay any attention. I mean, for example, how many refugees came to the United States? Well, the U.S. government wouldn't allow them in. They could have gotten refugees in.
There's a book published in Canada, One is Too Many, about the number of Jewish refugees allowed into Canada in that period.
Actually, more proportionally came to Canada. In fact, the most interesting story about this, in my opinion, is after the war. I mean, during the war, you can make all kind of reasons and excuses, fighting a war. But from 1945, no one was fighting a war. Jews were still dying in DP camps. In fact, at not a very different rate from under the Nazis. I mean, they weren't being thrown into gas chambers, but the conditions were such that the death rate was high, the conditions were awful, and so on. Simply ask yourself how many of them came to the United States. Suppose they'd had a choice. Where do you think they would have wanted to go? I mean,
sure.
Do you have to ask? They didn't come to the United States, and they didn't come to the United States for several reasons, one of them being that the American Jewish community didn't lobby to get them in, except for one sector, the anti-Zionist sector of the American Jewish community. It was then the Council for Judaism. They lobbied for Jewish immigration from Europe to the United States, but the organized part, in particular the Zionist movement, did not, for several reasons. One being that they didn't want them here in the United States, and the second reason is they wanted them to be essentially compelled to go to Palestine, what was becoming Israel. This is not a pretty story, and therefore not told very much, but that's the most striking story, in my opinion. During the war, you can make arguments. After the war, you can't make any arguments.
And was there not a concomitant story that at that very same time, Nazi war criminals were being welcomed into the United States to work on the NASA and so on?
Not just that. I mean, the SS guards from Latvia, there are probably more SS troopers from, Nazi sympathizers from Eastern Europe than there were Jews from DP camps, because they were being given priority. They were in what were called captive nations. They were taken over by the Russians, and therefore, for just plain Cold War reasons, priority was given to these captive nations people, of whom a substantial number were, maybe not concentration camp guards, but although some were, but pro-Nazi elements. There's some good historical work on this by some Jewish historians. Leonard Dinnerstein is one. Yeah.
Now, this brings us to perhaps the last example we could deal with in this conversation, this particular conversation, and that is the Cold War. And there were preparations for the Cold War. The Cold War was carried on, or Cold War I and Cold War II. Can you comment on the media's role in the reflection and the perpetuation and promotion of the Cold War?
Well, overwhelmingly, the media, it's a little unfair to talk about the media, because it's true of the intellectual community in general. The media are just the most visible part of it. But just keeping to the media, they almost uncritically accepted the framework of Cold War propaganda, which is, in my view, very distorted. I don't think the Cold War has been, I think it'll be a long time before we come to look at what the Cold War is, what it actually was. The fact of the matter is, as the better diplomatic historians have pointed out, the Cold War began in 1917. If you read, say, George Kennan, who, aside from being a major policymaker, is also a diplomatic historian, historian of Soviet-American relations, his big study of Soviet-American relations says that says that the breach between the West and the Russians, the Bolsheviks, the final breach, he said, occurred in January 1918 when the Bolsheviks offended our sensibilities by disbanding the Constituent Assembly. That, he said, caused the breach with an element of finality, and because we couldn't tolerate that with our love for democracy. Incidentally, a couple of months later, the Marines in Haiti disbanded the parliament by force, because they refused to approve a constitution written by the U.S. occupiers, which gave American corporations the right to purchase Haitian lands. So therefore, the Marines went in and, as Marine General Smedley Butler put it, dispersed them by genuine Marine Corps methods. Mm-hmm. And then the Marines ran their own referendum, in which they got something like 99.98% of the vote, with 5% of the population participating, and that didn't offend anyone's sensibilities. But when the Bolsheviks disbanded the Constituent Assembly, Kennan writes, this was just, Wilson and the British and so on were just horrified, and that's when the Cold War started. Well, apart from the obvious fraudulence of the reasons, as this single example demonstrates, he's right in the dating. It was Eastern Europe was part of the Third World. Russia was a third world country, in effect, and it had been for hundreds of years. And no part of the third world is allowed to strike an independent course. Doesn't matter whether it's a little speck in the Caribbean like Grenada or a sixth of the world. And that's when the Cold War started, and it sort of went on from there. Now, this framework is very important to understand. Otherwise, you can't understand anything that's happening now, as they're being driven back to essentially a third world status. But the media and the intellectual community have yet to even face these facts.
Here is where we'll have to conclude this, and it's so telling that you referred to Haiti, because now we'll turn, if we may, Noam, to Haiti first, then the Middle East for about 13 minutes, and I wonder maybe. And we'll have to forget what you just said, because that'll be another program in another month. Mm-hmm. But I shouldn't say we forget it. I mean, we could bring back that history, which is exactly what I was hoping you would do, is look at the history of American involvement in Haiti and up through the present day, and then that relate that to the media coverage of Haiti historically and to the present day. Would it be good to lead off with this clip?
Okay.
I think that's how we'll do it. So I'm going to, talking to the people behind the glass now, ask if we might start off with me looking at Julie's camera again, and then do our next conversation.
Fine, Barrie. It's wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And we went way over five minutes.
Yeah.
There.
Okay.
If there's anything goes wrong here, I'm responsible, and whatever credit there is goes rightly to you.
It's an easy position to be in. Yeah.
Okay, I need to just think for a moment. Okay.
Anytime you're ready.
Yeah. Noam Chomsky has followed the history of Haiti for a long time, back to connecting it to the origins of the Cold War, believe it or not. Noam, we have a little audio clip here that I'd like to play for us, and it is from a documentary on CBC, and it involves the Haitian elite. If we just listen to this for 30 seconds, and I'd appreciate your comment on it.
What he says is exactly correct, but I think he's speaking as a Haitian. Mm-hmm. We should speak as Westerners and look at ourselves the way he looks at Haiti. And it's true that the ruling class that he's talking about are one of the most grotesque in the world, and they look at the Haitians as animals. But it's worth remembering that, when Woodrow Wilson's Marines invaded Haiti, the racism of the American invaders shocked the Haitians.
That was what year?
That was 1915. And they stayed there till 1934, and they left the country a total wreck and under the rule of the National Guard, which is still running it. And also a plantation for American corporations. But one of the biggest impacts of the American invasion on Haiti was the extraordinary racism. They regarded all Haitians as animals, not just the ordinary Haitians. It wasn't just the soldiers who were extraordinarily racist, including the officers, but it goes all the way up to the top leadership. FDR, Franklin Roosevelt, who was then Assistant Secretary of the Navy, was still telling racist jokes about Haitians in the 30s. Woodrow Wilson's Secretaries of State, Bryan and Lansing, were vicious racists. Lansing said, well, you know, Haitians are Africans. They just have no capacity for self-government. It's just, irredeemable. Bryan was famous for his discovery that they spoke French. And he said, dear me, niggers speaking French. Isn't that funny, you know? And in particular, it was the educated Haitians, the ones who, many of them who were very educated and cultivated, who inspired the worst racist outbursts on the part of the American invaders, who were mostly louts, the impact of this on Haiti was extraordinary. I mean, it was a racist society. It had been for hundreds of years. They had, 130 different gradations of color, and you had to be in the right place, and it was connected with French origins and all sorts of stuff. But all of this was exaggerated by the extreme racism of the American invaders, and it had a big impact on what followed. Quite apart from that, the Americans restored, this is Woodrow Wilson, the great believer in self-determination, they restored virtual slavery, they carried out a counterinsurgency war in which they killed thousands of Haitians. According to Haitian historians, maybe 15,000 people or so died, maybe more. As I mentioned before, they destroyed the parliamentary system because they refused to ratify a U.S. written constitution. The crucial issue was alienation of land. The Haitian constitution didn't permit foreigners to buy up the lands. And this was considered illiberal by the Americans because it's liberal for Western corporations to be able to buy the land. So they simply rammed down their throats U.S. written constitution. Actually, Franklin Roosevelt took credit for writing it, though probably falsely, because he himself wanted to buy plantations there. It ended up with the country being essentially a U.S.-owned plantation. Exactly the same thing happened in the Dominican Republic next door in the same years, also under an invasion, American invasion. In both countries, when the U.S. left, they left it with new armies. For the first time, I mean, Haiti had not been a pleasant place, but now they had an army specifically created to control the population. That's the National Guard, and those are the killers of the last years. However, U.S. relations with Haiti don't start in 1915. They start in 1791, when this is the first foreign relations of the United States, right after its own revolution. Haiti had a slave revolution, and that terrified the West. The United States had one of the worst reactions to it, in fact. Haiti was, in fact, the first free country in the Western Hemisphere. The U.S. had a revolution, but it was a slave society, and Haiti was a free society. Not a pretty one by any means, but it was technically free. And that caused horror in the United States. All of Europe, including, crushed Haiti in order to get rid of this horror of slaves revolting and freeing themselves in what was at that time, remember, the richest colony in the world. It's not like it is today. That was one of the richest parts of the world. It's the source of much of the wealth of France, in fact, and Western Europe altogether. But for 60 years, the U.S. refused to recognize it and kept it under very harsh conditions. Afterwards, Haiti just became a plaything for imperial powers. Finally, the U.S. ended up being dominant by the early 20th century. Then the U.S. invaded, ran the place for 20 years, left it a total wreck. The U.S. supported the Duvalier dictatorship. During the last 10 or from about 1970 on, U.S. aid was pouring in there to try to turn Haiti into an export platform using super cheap labor, highly exploited labor, a big surplus because people are driven off the land by U.S. agro exports and so on. And that's what created the MEVs, the person who was talking before. They came out of this system.
These tiny elite.
Yeah, they're part of the system. I mean, it has roots in Haitian society. I'm not suggesting it was all imposed from the outside. There's plenty of roots in Haitian society. But it was exaggerated and made much worse and much more disgraceful by the long, in fact, two centuries impact of the West. This is after hundreds of years of, I mean, you really go back when Haiti is the first place where Columbus landed. And what he found was a place that he regarded as a paradise. It may have been the richest part of the world and maybe the most populous part of the world, and very peaceful. In fact, they were so peaceful, he thought they'll make perfect slaves, they'll never resist us. Well, within a couple of decades, they had wiped out the population, literally wiped it out. Then they brought in slaves who were treated absolutely viciously. You look back at the records of French slavery, I mean, it's mind-boggling. Finally, there was a slave revolt, and then came the history I described. So we have 500 years of history here, and it's not a pretty one. Haiti itself is almost like a parable of Western imperialism. I mean, rather like Bengal, which the British, when they got there, also regarded as a paradise. Haiti and Bengal are now, Bangladesh, are the symbols of despair. And that's after 500 years of European robbery and tutelage. I mean, Haiti may disappear in another couple of decades. This rich, super rich center of the world, which was literally one of the richest places in the 18th century, being robbed blind by the West, may turn into a desert in a few years. And that's not because of Haitians.
Noam, what you've just said, I imagine, would come as a revelation to a tremendous number of people, because you have drawn the historical picture. Would you relate this to media coverage, past, present, and future?
Well, there actually are studies of the media in the early part of the century during the Wilson invasion, and they simply supported it totally. I mean, the liberation of Haiti, I mean, it was just grotesque. But let's turn to the current period. The U.S. was turning Haiti into what the line was, they're going to turn Haiti into the Taiwan of the Caribbean. What they actually did was turn it into an export platform, where you have women working in factories for 10 cents an hour making baseballs, putting their hands into toxic substances so that the American manufacturers can advertise how well they're bonded and so on. If they die after a couple of years, there's plenty more. Wages went down about half during this period in the 80s when it was being turned into a miracle.
Now this would not, how was this reported if it was reported?
It was reported as an economic miracle. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Then everything was working fine, lots of profits, not only for the Mevs family and a couple of others in Haiti of that elite, but for plenty of Western manufacturers. U.S. aid money is pouring in there to create this monstrosity. Then you know, a lot of things happened, but they finally allowed a free election in 1990. Now, everyone thought that it was going to be a walkaway for the U.S. candidate. The U.S. had a candidate, Marc Bazin, World Bank official, and he had all the resources and all the wealth and so on. They figured, of course, he'll walk away, so it's safe to have a free election. Well, nobody was paying attention to what was going on in Haiti. I mean, who looks at the slums? You know, who bothers looking at the it's a peasant society. Who goes up and looks at the peasant community? What was going on there was that a very vibrant and lively civil society had been created. The basis for real democracy had been created, the kind of democracy that nobody in the United States even understands anymore. Jefferson would have understood it, but we've forgotten. They had grassroots movements and activism and populism, and nobody had paid any attention.
Was there any press coverage that you recall of that?
And nobody even, who looks, you know? Does anybody look at the slums? I mean, nobody even looked. When the election took place, it was a shock. A populist figure, a liberation theologist, won on a wave of a popular movement, and a lively, vibrant popular movement. Well, the U.S. moved at once to try to undermine him. The only question that should have been in anybody's mind is, how is the United States going to get rid of him? Because that kind of a figure and that kind of a movement is not permitted in U.S. domains. If people don't know that, they really are ignorant of modern history. So the question is, how are they going to get rid of him? The U.S. moved at once to try to undermine him. Aid stopped, except for the business community. So aid for investment stopped. The only aid that went in was to support the business community against Aristide. There's an Orwellian organization called the National Endowment for Democracy, and anyone who reads Orwell will know what it is, bipartisan organization, which is an attempt to create top-down type democracy, you know, the kind of democracy which is in the hands of elites and which people are kicked around. They moved in and they created counter-organizations to Aristide. Very surprisingly, it's exactly those organizations that survived the coup and then became the functioning organization, something which no one seems to have noticed. But the idea was to try to undermine Aristide. Now, he was in for 7 months, and that's a period of history which has now been wiped out of history. The official story is he was a mad theologian, impractical, and so on. The facts are quite different. He was extremely successful. He cut down narco trafficking, he cut down the bureaucracy, eliminated the deficit, he was beginning to create jobs. In fact, he so impressed the international lending community, like the Inter-American Development Bank and the World Bank and so on, not the big radicals, that they were offering him support. In fact, leaked State Department reports described their surprise at his success in taking this basket case and starting to turn it into a working society. That's all eliminated. When you read the reports today, it's, well, you know, he wasn't a good, didn't know how to run politics, we had to teach him, and so on. Finally, he was overthrown in a coup. Whether the U.S. was involved or not, nobody knows, but anyway, they certainly supported it. There was theoretically an embargo, but purely theoretically. The U.S. leads the way. Other countries don't do anything if the U.S. doesn't lead the way, and the U.S. made it very clear that they didn't want to take that embargo seriously. In fact, within a few weeks, George Bush had announced what he called an exception, namely U.S. manufacturing firms were allowed to violate the embargo. Well, if you take a look at U.S. trade figures with Haiti during the following year, they're not that far below the normal. It would take about 3 minutes for any journal to discover that, the same way I did, namely you call the Commerce Department. It has never been published. Under Clinton's first year, the trade went up by 50%. Including a huge increase in food exports from the starving island. So Fritz Mevs tells you how sad he is about the starving people. Yeah, they were exporting food to the United States under Clinton. The federal government, U.S. federal government, was purchasing stuff, that baseballs and things that were produced in these Haitian factories under the embargo. Now, actually, I'll just end with this. Right, the U.S. intervention took, the military, Cedras and Francois and so on, they were in effect told, look, you got a couple of years to murder people, to kill the leaders of the popular movements, to destroy them and decimate them. And when you're done with your, and there won't be much of an embargo during this period, so don't worry about it, you'll be fine. And when the job is done, you'll be sent off, but very happy. You know, you'll be wealthy, you'll have plenty of money, we'll take care of you. That's exactly what happened. I mean, I don't know if they were told in those words, but it was obvious that that was what was going on. And in fact, that's precisely what's happened. That's called restoring democracy. Okay, the job is done. The popular movements are decimated. The leadership is killed off. People are intimidated, or so it's hoped. Now the soldiers go in, and what they're restoring Aristide technically, purely technically. I should say that the day of the intervention, it was a Monday, if you remember, the day before that, Jimmy Carter was in Haiti having dinner with General Cedras and telling us what a nice man he was and so on and so forth, the leading killer. The biggest story of the intervention broke that day, and it has, as of now, yet to be reported in the mainstream in the United States. This is a couple of weeks. It was on every AP. It was on the AP wires, which means that every journalist found it out exactly the way I did by monitoring the AP wires. Every news desk knows that. On Sunday, the day before the intervention, Associated Press ran a major story on which they then repeated on a leak from the Justice Department concerning the way in which oil had been sent to Haiti. Oil's the main thing in the embargo, and everybody was watching Haiti, knew that oil was getting in. Well, how is it working? Turns out that it was being done with the approval of the U.S. government at the highest level, the cabinet level. That is, Texaco Corporation in particular was given a cease and desist order. Stop, because there was a presidential directive under Bush. So they were told, stop sending oil, cease and desist. But they were also informed that there would be no prosecution. And they then proposed to the Justice Department some chicanery by which they would do it, and were told, well, that's illegal, but we're not going to prosecute it. And that went on under Clinton as well. So in fact, there was no embargo. That's the biggest story of the day. Should have been, there never were any sanctions.
And I never heard that story.
Well, okay, but it's on the AP wires. Yeah. It's not a secret, I know it. Yeah, and I knew it right away. And I don't have more resources than the New York Times or the Globe and Mail, you know. I mean, it'll certainly leak out sooner or later because it's just, in fact, in small papers, like, you know, ones which don't really control the news properly, it came out a couple of days later. But in the mainstream, it's been kept out. But that's just a piece of it. All of this means, if we put it together, that while Aristide was in power, he was remarkably successful, and the U.S. tried to undermine him. After the coup, the U.S. backed off from sanctions. There were no sanctions, effectively no sanctions, except against the poor. They were directed against the poor. But the narco-trafficking went on. The military enriched themselves. The Mevs family, Fritz Mevs' family, were constructing a big oil refinery in Haiti under the embargo. What for? Well, you know, such a genius to discover. Then Aristide is now put in, but under very strict conditions. There's a reason why Fritz Mevs is distributing tens of thousands of pictures of Aristide all around Port-au-Prince, because he, as he says, considers that Aristide has become more mature while he's in Washington. In other words, he's learned that his job is to sort of shine Whitey's shoes, you know, at least so he hopes. So he's now more mature. He's become what the press calls pragmatic, meaning you follow orders. The orders are in a program, an economic program that was forced upon the Haitian government, the Aristide government. The way it's described is he presented the program to the Paris Donors Club. Yeah, he presented it. So it's a World Bank program, in effect, and it's the standard structural adjustment package. Anyone who knows about these things knows what that means. If you read it, it has some nice rhetoric, but the crucial line goes sort of like this. It says, the renovated government of Haiti will focus on civil society, particularly the private sector, domestic and foreign. So that means foreign investors are the central part of Haitian civil society, and that's where the resources will go. Now, this economic plan is yet to be reported. It's reported by a very good reporter, Alan Nairn, who's a freelance reporter in Multinational Monitor, which is a marginal journal. This was in August. It has yet to hit the press.
Unfortunately, we'll have to conclude here. There's more than a horror story there, Noam. But we'll have to turn to other if not equally important, equally serious questions. And we will now, we'll turn to the Middle East next. And because we elected to really turn over all of this Monday's program to Haiti, I'll ask for a countdown into, let's say, 4 minutes. On we'll try to go through about seven subjects, four
okay.
minutes each or something like that.
Well, you just warned me if I'm talking too long, because I tend to go on too long.
Well, yep. Look, I could just listen and listen
Well, the stuff starts coming out, but tell me, because,
I will indeed. Yeah. And I would be talking to the people behind the glass if with each of these briefer conversations, if I should start off, as it were, looking into Julie's camera.
Yes.
That's what they want?
Yes.
Sure. Okay. I know the Middle East is the first one, so it'll be the Middle East and then the 500-channel universe in
okay.
4 minutes.
Okay.
That'll be a trick. So I guess that actually we're ready.
Anytime.
Noam Chomsky has followed, among many other areas of the world, the Middle East with great care. And I'm going to start again. Noam Chomsky.
One moment, please.
Yeah.
We're going to give you 10 minutes for the Middle East.
Oh. There you go. Okay, 10 minutes.
Luxury.
And will we get a 3, 2, and 1?
Yes.
10 minutes on the Middle East, 3, 2, and 1. Right. Then we'll really speed through the others.
Anytime now,
Barry. Noam Chomsky is recognized as one of the foremost experts on the Middle East and media coverage of the Middle East. Noam, it's been my observation that for a long time there were nonviolent peace efforts in the Middle East, which I think were very much marginalized by the media. Using that as a starting point, how would you characterize media coverage of the Middle East?
Now talking about the United States primarily, because it's somewhat different than other countries. In the United States, the media coverage of the Middle East is absolutely the pits. It's the worst of any story I've ever looked at. And the reason is because although usually the press is subordinated to one state, in this case it happens to be subordinated to two states, one of them the United States and the other its major client. Since 1967, it was different before. But since 1967, the servility, and that's the only proper word to it, for it, has been both to the United States and its client state.
The servility of the media?
Of the media, overwhelmingly. I mean, to the extent that most of history has just been written out of the record. So take the nonviolent initiatives. Actually, the most important nonviolent initiatives are diplomacy. And there is a diplomatic record, though you wouldn't know it from reading the media. The diplomatic record includes crucial events which have simply been written out of history. For example, in February 1971, President Sadat of Egypt accepted a full peace agreement with Israel, full peace agreement, recognition, everything, almost precisely in accord with official U.S. policy. That caused a little turmoil in the United States. They had to decide whether to go along with Egypt and separate from Israel or break with their own official policy. They picked the latter under Henry Kissinger's influence. We know all about this. There's no dispute about the facts. Under Kissinger's influence, the U.S. just abandoned its policy and moved over to Israel's policy, which was no withdrawal. Kissinger called it stalemate. All right, Sadat's initiative is out of history. The standard line, even in scholarship, is that until his dramatic visit to Jerusalem in 1977, no Arab leader, including Sadat, was ever willing to consider peace with Israel, which is a total flat lie. I mean, journals like, say, Newsweek will not even accept letters, small three-line letters, referring to this fact, though they concede privately that they, in fact, even published it when it happened. So that's out of history. That's one diplomatic effort. That's what led to the 73 war. I mean, Sadat made it very clear that if the U.S. was going to block all diplomatic initiatives, he'd have no choice but war. Washington was warned by ambassadors, by oil companies, and so on, but Kissinger was so dense he couldn't understand it, not the only case. And finally there was a war, and it finally broke through the clouds that you got to do something. All right, now, let's go on with the diplomatic record. In January 1976, the Security Council debated a resolution which was brought by the Arab confrontation states, by Syria, Jordan, and Egypt, and backed by the PLO, and publicly backed by the Soviet Union, by Europe, by the non-aligned countries, in fact, by the whole world, just about, calling for essentially a two-state settlement. That would have ended it. It had all the wording of UN 242, you know, recognizing the territorial integrity and the existence and so on of all states in the region. All of that was in there, but it called for a Palestinian state in the West Bank and the Gaza Strip. Well, Israel was violently opposed, and the U.S. vetoed it at the Security Council. Now, this was reported at the time. You go back and you look at the New York Times at the time, you see, yeah, it was there, but it's out of history. The U.S. vetoed another Security Council resolution in 1980 of the same kind. Through the late 70s and the early 80s, there were all kinds of diplomatic initiatives coming from everywhere, including the PLO. Like Yasser Arafat was calling for negotiations with Israel leading to mutual recognition. The New York Times refused to publish it. They refused to publish letters to the editor referring to it. In fact, sometimes a friend of mine is a professor at a Midwestern university, actually got a letter back once from the foreign editor of the New York Times saying, we're not going to publish your letter on this because this is not to be said, basically. It's out of history. You know.
All of this time, the media, the typical phrase, is it not so, in dispatches would be this mysterious elusiveness of peace in the Middle East.
Yeah, it's elusive because the United States was blocking it. Yeah. For 20 years, the United States was leading the rejection front and blocking every diplomatic initiative. And it's not a secret. The Security Council vetoes are clear. Arafat's initiatives are clear. They're explicit. The General Assembly of the United... You can't veto anything in the General Assembly. So there was a vote every year in their winter session. And it would always ran like 150-2 or something. Sometimes, you know, 151-3. Once the United States picked up Dominica, it was the United States, Israel, and maybe one or another client state against the world. Out of history, you know. In fact, that continued until December 1990. And the reason it stopped at that point is that the world essentially conceded the region to the United States, said, okay, you run it. This was after the Gulf War. The Gulf War essentially established that the U.S. was going to run that region by force. The world backed off. The Madrid Conference started under unilateral U.S. control. And that's called the peace process because the U.S. was running it unilaterally and the world was out of the picture, and the U.S. ran it on its own terms. Its own terms are no withdrawal, except where Israel and the United States decide in opposition to the rest of the world, and nothing for the Palestinians. Those are the two U.S. positions. They are in the Madrid Conference in 1991 and right up to the Oslo agreements. So that's called the peace process. Now, it's interesting that U.S. power is so extraordinary in today's world that most of the West has now internalized the U.S. position. So, for example, I think most of Europe has probably forgotten what their own position was 3 years ago. It was very intriguing that Norway brokered this agreement. The reason for that was, in fact, described in the Israeli press. The Clinton administration has broken all records in service to Israel. In fact, it shocks the Israelis. They're to the right of the Israeli government, to the hawkish side of the Israeli government. And they probably figured that if they wanted to preserve any credibility in the Arab world, they better not do it through the Clinton administration, because that's like doing it through their own extreme right wing. So they therefore got Norway to broker the agreement. And it's interesting that Norway was willing and without second thought to broker what in fact was the U.S. rejectionist position. Nothing for the Palestinians and no withdrawal.
Would you venture any kind of prediction just in the short term about this Middle East situation, extrapolate it, and how the media will probably deal with that?
No, I think it's, you know, unfortunately very predictable. The U.S. has gotten its way. There is a settlement in which the Palestinians are marginalized. Israel has always, if you look back to the Israeli position since about 1968, it's been pretty uniform across this political spectrum from right to left. The idea is that Palestinians must not have any national rights. That's point one, so totally rejectionist. However, Israel should take what it wants in the occupied territories. What it wants is the usable land, the big area around Jerusalem, the resources of both the Gaza Strip and the West Bank, the Jordan Valley. They want to cantonize the region so you get little Bantustans. But they don't want to have to administer the local population. They want somebody else to be responsible for them. So Israel doesn't want to have to run Nablus, let's say. They'd like somebody else, Jordan, anybody. They don't want the responsibility. So that's been the proposal. It was first called the Alon Plan. The Sharon Plan is not very different. The current plan is exactly that. And that's going to be implemented. Exactly as the Israeli press says, and Israeli commentators say, they will move from, in their words, colonialism to neocolonialism. That's the phrase, and it's accurate. These regions will be under Israeli subordination, much the way Haiti is under U.S. subordination. And the press will describe that as peace. In fact, they'll win the Nobel. They just are winning the Nobel Prize for it.
Now, where would you suggest that our viewers could turn to gain the kind of facts and the kind of interpretation that inform your understanding of the Middle East?
The best place to turn is the Hebrew press in Israel.
Mm-hmm.
So, for example, actually a close friend of mine who's a professor at the Hebrew University, at the Tel Aviv University, Tanya Reinhart, wrote, just to pick one of 1,000 examples, an article recently in which she pointed out quite accurately that the current peace settlement has an analogy to South Africa, but not the usual one. It's not like the end of apartheid, it's like the beginning of apartheid. She pointed out that the current peace agreement is very similar to what the ultra-right nationalist government in South Africa instituted in the 1950s, namely the apartheid system, including Bantustans, little Bantustans, which were recognized as states by South African racists and some of their friends abroad, but not by anyone else. And she said that we are now in the stage where we're instituting South African apartheid in the style of the 1950s. This is, incidentally, in the major Israeli journal, Haaretz, it's kind of like the New York Times. And in fact, look, I write articles there. These journals are open, and there the discussion is quite open, and incidentally, a lot of this material is available in English. There's Israel Shachak, who's a former professor at the Hebrew University, and indeed a Holocaust survivor, translates and circulates material, translations from the Hebrew press, which are very illuminating. You want to know what's going on, that set of translations is 1,000 times better than anything you read in the West.
Well, regrettably then, as we close this, it appears that there is not the basis for lasting just peace in the Middle East.
Not just
so,
peace.
Not just, and so we'd better inform ourselves better than ever. Thank you. I was thinking that some sort of a more or less formalized conclusion was in order. Was I right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So now and by the way, I guess I clearly see your 3 and your 2 and your 1, Julie. Thanks. And then you do this.
That's a wrap.
But then I'm actually not clear. Would you then give a faster wrap and maybe just some sort of a signal that our time has in fact run out? Especially since now we're going to try to do the rest in 3 minutes each. Yeah, or 2, because someone should call a cab and make sure the cab is absolutely cut you off. Yeah.
Okay, stand by, Barrie.
We're going after actually 2 minutes each, okay?
Anytime.
Noam Chomsky, I believe, invented the phrase intellectual self-defense. Noam, what do you mean by that?
I mean by it the standard attitude that anyone in the sciences takes towards their work. Namely, you look at everything skeptically. Somebody comes along with a result that looks interesting. You ask yourself, well, is it really true? I mean, did you look at it the right way? Could there be some other evidence that he overlooked? I'll do it a different way, and so on. If you don't understand that, you can't work in the sciences. I mean, I happen to teach in a scientific university. This is just second nature. Well, that's the attitude that people should take towards things that really matter in life. You read something in the newspapers, there's a peace process in the Middle East, that we're restoring democracy in Haiti. First question any sensible person should ask is, well, I mean, is there a power interest that would want things to be looked at that way? Answer, well, obviously, yes. Does that infect the coverage? Well, I'll investigate. And, of course, you find out very quickly, yes. And then you say, well, what are they not telling me? What wouldn't they want me to know? What wouldn't they want me to think? Okay, I'll look for that. I mean, you know, this ought to be second nature to everyone. And in some small areas, like, say, the sciences, it is second nature. In fact, there wouldn't be any sciences otherwise. In areas that matter to human life, there has been a huge effort to drive that out of people's heads. And it's taken centuries, literally. You read the working class press in the 19th century, which was very lively and independent and done by working class women and men, a lot of women, incidentally, who were editing newspapers and so on. It raised all these questions all the time. I mean, it's taken a century of indoctrination to drive out of people's heads the idea that you should think.
Now, someone has added to your phrase and said we also need, in light of the entertainment media, emotional self-defense. How would you respond to that?
Well, very much so, because actually my own work is kind of misleading in this respect. I focus mostly on that sector of the intellectual culture and the media that's directed to the educated sector of the population. But probably 90% of the propaganda is something else. It's just intended to divert people, to get them away from things, to turn their brains into mush, you know. They could just keep them away from the public arena so we can run it in peace. That's what almost all the media are. And I don't personally write about that, partly because I don't know much about it. But so you need the kind of self-defense which says, look, they want you to focus on the O.J. Simpson car chase. Why? Because there's other things going on that are important that you might do something about. You better not think about them. You better look at the car chase.
Supreme distraction.
Yeah.
That's very interesting. Oh, are you giving Tim signs too?
Oh, I just realized.
Yeah,
terrific.
No, that was good. That was good.
I would appreciate that. Yeah, that's right.
I noticed.
I can see her in my peripheral vision, but...
Yeah, no, that was good. Thanks.
I think we should do that. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, then. We're ready for the next one.
Okay. Bear on board. Yep, anytime.
Disinformation is a phrase for outright lies, complete fabrications in the media. Noam Chomsky, can you give us one example of disinformation today?
Well, everything we've been talking about is disinformation. If the Nobel Prize is coming for three people who brought peace, that's disinformation. What they brought is traditional U.S. rejectionism after 20 years of blocking peace. The U.S. is supposed to be restoring democracy in Haiti. That's disinformation. What the U.S. is doing is undermining the possibilities of popular democracy in Haiti. And we can go down the list. And incidentally, this disinformation is with the collusion of the media. If you actually pay attention, you can see it happening. Oh, let me just give you one personal incident. I happened to be in Laos at a time when virtually the whole Western press corps was there, because Richard Nixon had just made a speech saying there was a North Vietnamese invasion, so everybody flew in and very excited. The journalists in Laos, a very easy place to follow the news because all the journalists are in the same hotel. There's actually two hotels in this cow town, and the richer one is where most of the journalists were, especially the fancy ones. So they're all sitting around the bar laughing about Nixon's speech because they all know it's a total lie. In fact, they had just had a briefing from the U.S. military attaché who hadn't heard the speech yet, and he told them didn't say anything about it. So they all know it's a total lie. They're telling jokes about it and drinking and so on. You take a look at the next day's paper, they all reported the North Vietnamese invasion of Laos. Well, you can say disinformation if you like, but it's a funny use of the word. And this happens all the time. Any working journalist can tell you that.
How about such as the reports that we're reading now that secret KGB files are being unearthed in the Soviet Union, and they say all sorts of strange things?
Mm. Actually, the most interesting... I mean, there are a lot of people here working like hawks on those files, trying to find some support for U.S. Western propaganda over the years. And what's been dramatic is how little they've been able to find. Almost nothing has come out. So take all the big stories, you know, like the Russians are trying to assassinate the Pope or, you know, that kind of stuff. Well, it's interesting that nothing is coming along. And it's not that people aren't looking. I mean, they're dedicating enormous efforts to try to find any scrap of information that can buttress traditional Cold War propaganda. And to this, strikingly, virtually nothing has come out.
But do not CIA operatives actually create fictional documents?
Yeah.
There were those famous papers.
Yeah, there's a lot of fakery, but, you know, and it does exist. I mean, actual intelligence fakery does exist.
Yeah.
But in my opinion, it's a sort of a marginal phenomenon. First of all, it's easily penetrated. Secondly, the worst part is the kind of thing I've just described. It's the willing collusion with power, or even worse than that, the internalization of values that doesn't make that it that prevents you from seeing that you're colluding with power.
In other words, self-censorship.
Yeah.
Thank you on that.
We're just changing.
Noam Chomsky, the world's leading media critic, refers a lot to print. Noam, I was at a talk recently, and one of Canada's leading media critics, a young man named Jeff Pevere, told the audience, he said, I understand Noam Chomsky does not watch television. And then he went on to say, I also understand he only watches one movie a year. And then he said, I'd love to know what that movie is, and everybody laughed. Is it true you don't watch television? Mm-hmm. Is it true you just see one movie a year? And if that's true, what is it?
Well, probably not literally true, but it's sort of more or less in the ballpark. I do watch television news, you know, and occasionally we'll watch a television program, you know.
Such as?
Something diverting, you know, Northern Exposure or, you know, I don't know, something or other.
Mm-hmm.
You know, tired at night, but not very often. As for movies, you know, I'd like to be able to, there's just no time, you know, so.
What's the last movie you saw, and why did you go to it? You've got to answer.
My son was visiting us and over a couple, well, about 6 months ago, and he told us we should go to a movie, and we said, well, what's the only movie playing at the local, you know, collection of movies? And it turned out to be Forrest Gump.
Oh, yes.
So we went and saw Forrest Gump.
And before Forrest Gump, what was the previous movie?
The one before that I actually enjoyed. It was a movie called Sail. I liked to sail. And it had marvelous sailing scenes. It was, I think, about the America's Cup. Unfortunately, they interspersed. They figured they had to have a story. So they had a storyline, which was so idiotic, it was embarrassing. But if you kind of turned off during the storyline and just watched the sailing scenes, it was really terrific. So that one I liked. You know?
That's typical Noam Chomsky. You want concentrated sailing, never
right.
mind the storyline.
Yeah.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much.
Actually, it was called Wind, I think.
Oh, Wind? Oh, no.
I got it wrong.
That's too late. It's too late now.
Late.
We have to fly like the wind ourselves.